look at that patient. First of all, how do patients get in that broken down state? Sometimes I wonder, I look and I think, wow, I could put a periodontal poker in there and go down about 6 millimeters. Juices would run out all over the patient's face. Periodontal disease, caries, what's going to happen to those teeth? They're going to be in a bucket very, very shortly. But here's the question. How do I duplicate that vertical dimension of occlusion from that state? If I make impressions and mount it, I would have vertical dimension of occlusion only with the teeth in. But the teeth are going to go away. There they are. Now I'm faced with a toothless patient. How can I figure out vertical dimension of occlusion either in that immediate denture orientation or in a remote denture orientation? Let's have the patient do a few simple, simple things. Let it heal for a while, obviously. Let's stay with a remote one for just a second. The patient comes in, they've had dentures forever. Have them open their mouth widely and let them relax and have them slowly close down as I'm doing right now. Watch me until my lips touch. Then have them slip their tongue between the teeth or the jaws. If there are any teeth left, it would be between teeth. But let's say it's a dentulous. But that area, when those lips touch, watch me again. If I close all the way, watch. What did I just close? About 4 millimeters, 3 or 4. So when the lips touch, if it's a normal facial musculature, that is called rest. You know that. And how much farther should maximum intercuspation be? Let's try it again. I'll close till my lips touch and then I'll go all the way. Here we go. Did you see that closure? It's about 3 to 4 millimeters. And that's a start for the occlusion rims, or what you normally call bite blocks. So I've got that vertical dimension close. Now back come the occlusion rims from the laboratory technician. And the laboratory technician, I hope, has made them a little more open than they really need to be, because all I need is a knife and about 30 seconds to carve off a little wax, but it'll take me a minute or two or three to add wax, so I'd like them a little bigger, not much. Now, let's put them in the mouth, and let's have the patient say anything with an S sound, such as what? Mississippi. I'm going to part my lips as I say that, and you see how far my teeth are apart. Mississippi, about 1 to 2 millimeters. If those bite blocks touch, I better carve some more off. Let's do it again. NES sound. Mississippi. And you'll see the teeth come almost together. If the bite blocks touch, cut some more off. If it's an older person, a very old person, like 70, 80, 90, that particular person has usually been accustomed to dentures that were far overclosed. If you try to open up to the Mississippi level, they're going to hate you. So you have to respect the fact that those people are used to a closed vertical dimension, leave them somewhat at a closed vertical dimension. Bottom line is, if you use these few simple rules, you can make it fairly easy. The portion where the lips touch is usually made at the sound of M. You've heard the name Emma. M. I just closed 4 millimeters from that. Emma. Emma. And you're down 3 or 4 millimeters. So M and S. And if you place a dot on the tip of the nose and on a fairly stable part of the chin, that patient now can be measured from those two dots at rest and then close them down 3 millimeters or so if they're a middle-aged person. If they're an older person, I'd probably close them a little more. And you end up with that first patient looking fairly civilized. This is not really rocket science, I think you know. But it can be determined quite well. Just don't open them too much, or the muscles quit working, and you have challenges with the meeting, and you'll be remaking it. you're slightly better to be a little overclosed than underclosed. Well, give it a try. It can work quite simply. Thanks for being with us. Join us next week.